Hey everyone, we're back with another episode of The Buzz. On today's show, we talk to Larkin Poe. In our artist spotlight, we talk to Capitol recording artist Chaz Cardigan. And then we catch up with James Aides and Harris Weisskopf of the World of Dance to update us on the competition. And then we have some buzz news with Maddison Hill. We got a lot of show today, so let's get started.
Hi, my name is Rebecca.
And I am Megan. Together we are Larkin Poe.
Let's get buzzed.
Grammy-nominated sister duo Larkin Poe just released their Self-Made Man album this past June, and we catch up to Rebecca and Megan Lovell to talk about how they're staying creative during this quarantine, and how their album Self-Made Man is more than just a play on words. Let's take a look.
I am Rebecca.
And I am Megan. Together we make up Larkin Poe.
The trees down in Georgia grow as tall as a grass, where little Richard was singing, where rock and roll learned to walk. Country blues in a battle, get those tubes running hot, till the serpents start hissing, y'all let me out of this box. Streets of gold, ain't that red or clay?
We've been hanging on for dear life. We've been keeping really busy. We made a record in, I guess, January, February of this year, and that came out, what, June?
Yeah, so just about a month ago.
Yeah.
So it's still pretty new, still pretty fresh.
Mm-hmm. Trying to promote an album during quarantine, it's caused us to think a lot more creatively, like think outside the box about how to connect with people and to make it feel exciting and fun in the absence of shows, because I mean that's definitely a huge part of my life, and to have that missing is pretty crazy.
I know we've gotten pretty comfortable at performing in front of a camera,
yeah,
instead of people.
Right. I think it's been good pressure in some ways. We've been trying to move through the quarantine as productively as possible, but mostly just because we are very like high octane individuals, in that we're always moving, we're always doing something. So being stuck in one place, it has the potential to be a little bit crazy making. So we actually got in the studio ourselves and made this record that we haven't actually even really talked about with anybody, but it's going to be coming out later in the year. And just trying to keep the creative juices flowing, because the last thing that we want is to become stagnant. And I think especially in times where there's a lot of turmoil and unrest for humans, that is our time as artists to shine and try to reflect, you know, some of those uncertain feelings in the art as well.
Absolutely. Because we were right on the cusp of a big tour for the record release. So we were like looking over the cliff, like down into the abyss, ready to go on our first like tour bus tour. And then it got like yanked out from underneath us. So there was a period of readjustment, but I think, you know, we roll with the punches, and it actually has been great to be at home and be able to still be creative.
Mm-hmm. This year has been such a year of learning for us as sisters, and the conversations that we're having with people, I think it's really gonna spark some growth. I mean, for me as an individual, I feel like I've been confronted with a lot of new ideas, and you know, or maybe not even new ideas, but feeling a different need to connect and to express more of my own feelings in my art. I do feel that there's going to be that type of a shift this year for us as Larkin Poe. And you know, we make music to create joy. Like that's for us one of the biggest things that we strive for in making music and putting on shows, is to really have a safe harbor for people to come and have a good time, and maybe not to escape their problems, but at least to put them in context and perspective, and to be able to have an enjoyable, you know, joyful, fun-filled evening. So I look forward to writing songs that can hopefully be an outlet for people in connecting with their own feelings, but then also just having an awesome time. Because I mean, like getting to go to a rock show, dang, I miss it.
Down in the kingdom.
Going down to Mississippi, pain and misery. it's interesting, especially in the Americana or the country realms, a lot of people, you use the word escapism, and there definitely is kind of this this facade that can exist for certain artists mm-hmm. with social media. And so I think being willing to break through that and be real with people, there is so much strength in that, in coming together and experiencing vulnerability. And it's been really amazing, I think, for us. I mean, just based on the quarantine, like, we've been spending a lot more time, you know, connecting with people through internet and through our Instagram and Facebook and everything. And it's been really educational to just have conversations with people and to not let it devolve into something that's name calling or hateful or any of that. Just being willing to open up and talk with people. I think we've seen a great shift with artists, and I definitely for us as well. Mm-hmm.
No, it's just like one of those type of things that, again, it's like I just like to just put the needle on the record and just get away for a few minutes. I think you guys always give us that. But we got some business to take care of, so let's talk about Self-Made Man. First of all, how did the title come about, and tell us the whole process behind that?
Man, so... Like it or not, I don't give a damn. Lord have mercy, I'm a self-made man. I found myself, like, throughout my life, I've said the phrase self-made man so many times. Like, I can't even count how many times I've said that. And it had never occurred to me until I sat down to write the song that I was qualifying the idea of success by gender, by saying self-made man. And once that kind of clicked in my head, it really, like, was a burr under my saddle. And so I wanted to write a song where I claimed that. And you know, and actually look dead in the eye of this kind of inequality piece and really shine a light. Like, my sister and I, we feel like self-made men in terms, like, we feel like we've been successful for, you know, the world in which we've lived and been real do-it-yourselfers and kind of pulled ourselves up by our bootstraps with the help of a lot of really incredible people, but also a lot of hard work. And so wanting to make a record that that kind of poked fun at that adage was important to us. So that's where the title came from. There's been a lot of pushback. I think people are a little uncomfortable by us saying that we're self-made men. And it's been really interesting. Like, we've done so many interviews all across Europe. And so getting to have the different cultural perspectives on us having said that we are self-made men, it is very confusing and kind of like edgy for some people. And I'm glad that we ended up sticking with the title, because I don't know that we were trying to be edgy, but it's something that strikes very near and dear to our hearts, you know, wanting to be honest with people. And, you know, and if something rubs us the wrong way, to be able to talk about that and see what conversations it sparks.
And so it has a lot less to do with gender and just being a do-it-yourselfer, you know, because, like, we started our own record label and we're self-producing the album. So being a self-made man isn't about being a man, it's about being self-made.
Yeah, and inspiring people to hopefully, like, dig in and figure out what they're capable of, what sets them on fire, what's exciting. Wanting to just, as much as possible, fight for the equal playing field for everybody. Like, obviously there are differences and uniqueness to each and every person, and that's what makes life interesting. But as much as, you know, in the public sector, like when everyone's trying to do their job or just, you know, be in the world, to let it be an equal playing field and to not let there be these kind of like insidious little things in our vocabulary as humans that are holding people down potentially. Yeah, we got creative making music videos for this record because we were in quarantine. And so I got Final Cut Pro, which is a video editing software, and I started figuring out how to edit the videos ourselves. Megan and I both filmed each other. My husband filmed us. It was like a real mother of invention type project. So it's been fun.
And then, of course, our Tip of the Hat covers video series has still been going on. That's been going on for like, what, three years now? And we've been making a lot of videos now in quarantine. That's just opened up a lot of avenues and time for us to learn more covers.
It's been fun. Yeah, we're at Larkin Poe, LARKINPOE on everything. And we manage all the socials and stuff. So people get in touch. We see it. So do come and follow us and hang out. We're a big family, and you know, just come comment and we'll see what kind of connections we can make here.
Self-Made Man is streaming on all platforms. You can also catch Rebecca and Megan on their YouTube channel if you want to know more about them and listen to some creative covers. Don't go anywhere. We have James and Harris of the World of Dance. We'll be back after this. Best friends and bros for life, James and Harris talk to us about their audition process on J-Lo's World of Dance. They talk about their chemistry and auditioning for the judges. Let's take a look.
He's James, and I'm Harris, and together, we're James and Harris.
Definitely most amazing experience of my life. Seeing the three judges up there, a feeling I'll never be able to recreate. It's pretty surreal, pretty crazy.
Yeah. When we got there, we were told that there were just going to be producers for qualifiers, but we didn't really think that it was going to be just the normal judges and Jennifer, Neo, and Derek. So when we got out there, it was like, so authentic, like I was not expecting a thing. And then just the experience overall was so amazing. Everyone's so nice. It didn't really always feel like a competition just because everyone is so inspiring and loving and caring. And you just, it's hard to get in a competition mindset when you love everyone, but you still have a job to do and you got to go do it. Mm-hmm.
How great was production keeping that secret? Because I'm sure it's kind of hard after like the first 10 or something like that.
They were too good at it.
Yeah.
They were too good at keeping secrets.
They're really good.
Like, there were so many cases or like moments where I was like, what is going on? Yeah. So props to them for keeping everyone on the line. I feel like for our qualifiers piece, it was very emotional and it was very real, and it was a story that is super deep and meaningful to both of us. And we found that contemporary was probably the best style to portray that story because there's so much freedom and room for us to release everything and put everything out there and really get, I guess, more on the more lyrical aspect inside of that, but then plus the contemporary, which gave us that like movement.
That it was the best way to emotionally express ourselves and really let it all out there. If you love it, then stick with it.
For sure.
Other people's opinions shouldn't affect your happiness and what you love to do.
And
if you have a passion for it, then
stick with it. Yeah, sorry, I didn't mean to interrupt you, but along with that, no one can tell you who you are because of what you love to do. And I think that's a really big thing, and it took me a really long time to realize that, was like, there was always assumptions of my character and who I am, but in the end, I decide who I am and what I do and what kind of person I want to be, and there's no one else I'd rather want to be than a dancer. Mm-hmm. They don't want me better, they just want me broke, but never listen, at least I admit it, black out all my vision, watching me diminish.
So our choreographer is Patrick Polkerbeck, and he's our like dance coach at our studio. He trained us in ballet and like lyrical, and goes through our rehearsals all the time. And we, throughout the process of choreography, we had a lot of freedom in like contributing and throwing in ideas about how would you want the piece to go. And so I feel like the three of us worked really well together.
For sure. It was super collaborative.
Yeah.
Like we were always talking. There was always movement and discussion. And I think that made a perfect environment for kicking up some choreo.
Yeah.
Does your friendship and bond help the choreography go a little easier?
Ooh, definitely. For sure. Yeah, for sure. But it also can like, I mean, it's a blessing and a curse. Like there's times where it's like, I swear to God. Like there's times where we're like just at each other and like, we're like, if I see James, I'm going to rip his face off. Like, but literally like 5 minutes after we're like that, we're like, oh, what's up?
Yeah,
what's
we cannot hold a grudge.
Yeah.
We cannot hold a grudge.
It's like 5 minutes. We like hate each other. And then like 2 minutes later, we're like, oh, come here. Like, I don't know. I mean, who knows what the world holds right now.
Yeah.
Like, the industry is super kind of hard to read right now with coronavirus. And we still have one more year of high school left. So we're going to finish out our training at our studio and graduate. And then I'm going to be applying to colleges personally. I'm hoping to get into Loyola Marymount University and then possibly deferring year and trying to take a year to dip my toes in the industry. And then who knows what comes after that. I mean, James is my best friend and my brother, so
yeah.
Going on the road with him is just like going on the road with family. So I'd love to do something like that. We'll see what opportunities arise, but I mean, I'd love that.
Yeah. My name is James.
My name is Harris. And you've just been buzzed.
The World of Dance is on Tuesdays at 10 p.m. on NBC. Up next in our artist spotlight, we have Chaz Cardigan. Don't go away. Chaz Cardigan just released the official video for his new single, Everything's Wrong, off his Vulnerabilia 2020 EP, which examines living with panic disorder. I think we can all relate right now. Check out Chaz Cardigan in our artist spotlight.
My name's Chaz Cardigan. I make music, make videos, write songs, produce songs. I've been making music since I was about 10 years old, playing gigs since I was about 11, taught myself to produce, play a bunch of instruments, moved to Nashville after high school instead of going to college, and made money producing records for rappers, played every instrument you can think of for a billion people while I was working on my project. And then sometime around 2017, it just started working. All the gears started clicking into place. I played South By, put out a bunch of singles that did pretty well on Spotify. And then, I don't know, sort of blinked and then signed a record deal with Capitol. It's about time I felt something new running. I, as a kid, fell in love with artists like Prince and David Bowie and Stevie Wonder and Beck. And my, like, when I was about 9, I remember thinking, oh, if I want to make music, I have to learn to produce records. So when I was about 10, I saved up some money from, you know, summer chores or whatever, and I got like a little 4-track tape recorder, and I was teaching myself to record on that and learning how to pan, like really basic, but learning the basics. And I always had this understanding that if I wanted to make music and put it out, I just needed to learn to do it myself, because there was just no network where I grew up to do that. In the last couple years, I definitely started leaning more into making music I wish I heard as a teenager, which is definitely, you know, pop choruses, but messy guitars, some hip-hop elements in there, like fuzzy basses, big 808s, some more like rap influenced rhythm patterns, rhyme schemes, but at the same time it could have been like a Goo Goo Dolls or a Third Eye Blind record. Everything's Wrong, first song I wrote after I finished my EP Vulnerabilia. Vulnerabilia is a lot about my mental health, exploring like my panic disorder and these like cycles I've been in for a long time. After I got done with that, I said to myself, I don't just want to do that forever. I love a lot of artists who write about their mental health, but a thing that kind of bums me out is when someone just writes the same song for 20 years, and I really quickly was like, I don't want to do that. I don't just want to like revel in this forever. And so Everything's Wrong with me figuring out what comes after the bad day. Because I'm a happy person. I have loads of good days, and like I can write about bad days pretty honestly, and Everything's Wrong was this like liberation that you get, I think, on a bad day. The chorus is, everything's wrong and I've never been better. Guess I'm just not what I wanted all along, but it only gets better. It's this thing that, like, when I'm in, like, a breakdown or when everything's crashing around me, I always say to myself, okay, well, can only go up. And turns out, I didn't do the thing right, but now I know that, and I can get it right the next time. I mean, look, everyone has anxiety. Everyone has deep insecurity. We all have deep trauma. We're all unlearning those things, and some people get there later than others, and it's easier for some people than others. But I do think like the conversation has shifted in such a good, healthy way that we can talk about these things. I don't think they always get talked about in the most healthy way. So I feel like culturally, especially, man, there's just so many systemic issues that I think we're all processing in real time. And I think you're seeing that in music, especially these younger kids writing music, me, I guess me being one of them, where we're processing these really deep insecurities and anxieties that there's not an answer for, but we have to process the feeling so that the feelings are on the table and then we can find solutions.
Why are you so fixed on being somebody that you wouldn't like if you met him at a party? Why is it so hard to keep your own opinion and not break under pressure like a politician? It's about time I felt something new running around my mind like an animal, looking for one good goddamn excuse. I wish I could, I wish I could just let it go. Everything's wrong, everything's all wrong, and I've never been better. Guess I'm just not what I wanted all along, but it only gets better.
Hi, my name is Chaz Cardigan, and you've just been buzzed.
Everything is Wrong is out now, so be sure to check it out. Don't go anywhere. Maddison Hill is on deck with some buzz news.
What's up, you guys? You're watching The Buzz, and it's time for another rap party with me, your girl, Maddison Hill.
Where my party people at?
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 First up, we are celebrating because Joe Jonas and Sophie Turner welcomed their first child into the world this week. Us Weekly confirmed that they did have a baby girl, and they named her Willa. Now, this is not a family name. However, it is something that the young couple picked out a long time ago. In my opinion, when it comes to Willa, I think it gets a 10 out of 10, especially when it comes to celebrity baby names. I don't know, I think it is super cute, and I love Joe Jonas and Sophie Turner. They're one of my favorite young celeb couples. I feel like they're so real, they're very authentic. I absolutely love them, and I'm so happy that they became parents this week, and now they're a family of three with baby Willa. Okay, we're moving right along to some weird but yet piping hot celebrity tea involving Kanye West and Justin Bieber. So as you all know, Kanye West has been in Wyoming. He's been working on new music. He also has definitely been going through it when it comes to his mental health. This week, we also saw Kanye actually come face to face with his wife Kim after going off about her on Twitter. Now, Kim was seen crying in the pictures that we saw of her and Kanye, so we don't really know what happened during that conversation, but we do know that Kim ended up coming back to LA alone, sans Kanye. Now, you're probably wondering, how does Justin Bieber tie into all of this? Well, Justin Bieber, according to People Magazine, is the one who got Kim and Kanye talking. So a source told People Magazine that up until this point, Kanye had been ghosting Kim, not returning her calls, not returning her texts, and his good old pal, the Biebs, is reportedly the one who told him to stop ghosting his wife and to definitely give her a text and call back. I know, I didn't know Justin was mature enough to handle this situation, but the same People Magazine source said that Justin has gone through his own individual mental health struggles. He also understands the pressure an artist can be under when they're coming out with new music. So him and Haley spent some time with Kanye on the ranch in Wyoming. He got Kanye to call Kim. I'm still mind-boggled by the situation. I know the two are friends thanks to Scooter Braun. Sorry, Scooter Braun is not my favorite human, but I know he did bring these two together. And normally, I feel like Justin does a lot of things for stunts and attention, but I'm going to try to see the good in him and try to believe that this was all for the best and that he was truly just being a good friend to Kanye and telling him that he needs to contact his wife. So hopefully, Kanye can get the help that he absolutely needs. Okay, last up, we're talking about my girl Taylor Swift, also Selena's bestie, because fans have a lot of theories involving her new song, Cardigan. So Taylor Swift recently put out her new album, Folklore. It is amazing, as we all expected. And now that fans have had some time time to really dissect the lyrics and dissect her new music video. They think that they have found a clue about who inspired Cardigan, and they think that person is Taylor's ex, Harry Styles. Now, this has been a theory going wild on Twitter. People are comparing the Cardigan music video to Harry Styles' music video for his song, Falling. And I've gotta say, the evidence is pretty damning. There are some very, very similar shots. However, I don't think this is a sign that Taylor and Harry have any sort of future. I do think it's possible that Taylor might have written the song about Harry. She said this whole album is made up of stories that are her own, of other people's stories, from stories told from different perspectives. So while I absolutely think the song could have been written about Harry Styles, I just want to let all of the Taylor shippers know these two are not headed for a reconciliation. I'm sorry. I truly believe Taylor is happy with Joe Alwyn, and I'm happy with Joe Alwyn because he is making our girl creative to produce amazing music like this. So, well, yes, I can see maybe why people think that Cardigan was written about Harry Styles. Sorry, Taylor shippers. I don't want it to happen. For more stories and features, head on over to thebuzzallaccess.com. You can find me on Instagram at I am Maddison Hill. Also, don't forget to check out my YouTube channel. One last time, I'm your girl Maddison Hill, and you've just been buzzed. Where my party people at? Where my party people at? Where my party people at?
That's all we have. Special thanks to Maddison Hill, Chaz Cardigan, NBC, James and Harris, and Larkin Poe. Don't forget to like us on Facebook, follow us on Twitter, and double tap us on Instagram, all at Buzz_Access. Please practice social distancing, wash your hands, and avoid Karens at all costs. I'm Trey Rich. Love and light to you all. For more stories and extended clips, go to thebuzzallaccess.com. I'm Trey Rich, and you've just been buzzed.